What's up, EBRs? Brent here, and today we're doing something a little bit different. This isn't going to be a review of a particular electric bike so much as it is a kind of an in-depth deep dive of the differences between belt drives and chain drives. I've been asked on more than one occasion, like, what's the point of a belt drive on electric bikes, or what's the pros and cons of a belt drive versus a regular chain drive? So we are going to check that out today. And I've got two bikes from Pure Cycles. This is the Pure Cycles Volta single speed right here. This is the Pure Cycles 8-speed. So this is cool to have these two bikes because they're really exactly the same except for, you know, one key difference. This one has a 8-speed with a chain. This one has a single speed with a belt. And we've actually reviewed both of these bikes on EBR. So if you guys do want to check out the actual full review of these bikes, we will leave the links here in the description. You can check those out. But basically, there's a few, you know, kind of key differences really between a belt drive and a chain drive. And I think first and foremost is that, you know, with a belt drive like this right here, this is what it looks like, okay? Typically, you know, sometimes they're made out of like a Kevlar weave. They're pretty durable, but normally speaking, with a belt drive, it's only going to be a single speed. There's a couple of ways to get, I mean, really there's only one really, oh, hey, hold still. Really, there's only one kind of good way to make this, you know, a multiple speed bike with a belt drive, and that's by having a continuously variable transmission here in the back, like the Nuvinci CVT system, which is really cool. However, you know, if we were to do that with a belt drive here, that means, right, if there's a CVT here in the back, that continuously variable transmission, that would mean I'd have to get rid of this hub motor. Okay, well, if I don't have a hub motor in the back, well, what else am I gonna do to make this an electric bike? Well, there's a couple of main options. I could definitely put a mid-drive motor. That would give me propulsion. Or if I wanted to stick with a hub motor, I could put a hub motor here in the front. However, I don't particularly like hub motors in the front wheel simply because there's a little bit more of a chance to get wheel slippage. It can make the bike a little bit difficult to steer because of that extra weight in the front wheel. It can affect steering. So I prefer to have, you know, hub motors in the back or a mid-drive. And of course, you know, we could go with the old school route. I forgot what they're called, but it's the old like friction motors, you know, where it's like the motor will spin and actually creates contact with this tire, and then it gives propulsion that way. Not the most effective, and really it's not something I would want to do for this bike. But again, if I did want to make this, you know, multi-speed, it could be done, just not really that easily. And I think, you know, in my opinion, one of the best things about the belt drives, right, is they're just so easy to operate. They're absolutely silent. Like when I'm pedaling this thing, I can't hear the belt moving at all. I don't hear any noise with the belt or the front chainring, the rear sprocket, and there's no noise. It's just so quiet and so stealthy. And especially with a bike like this that has a gearless hub motor, this thing just, it really flies under the radar. And I think for me, kind of coming from a fixie culture, you know, that simplicity, that ease of use with the belt, that's one of the things that appeals to me. Another really big pro here with the belt drive, I'm gonna get real close here so you guys can hopefully see, but you know, there's no grease. It's clean. Like I'm gonna put my fingers all over it, and then there's really no grease or anything on my hands. And what that translates to is it's just a cleaner ride overall. Like you'll see there's no chain guard here on this, nothing to really protect your pants from getting dirty, but in this case it's really not necessary because there's no chain grease on this. Also, generally speaking, with a belt drive, it's going to be lower maintenance. You know, they don't have to be switched out very often at all. Now, of course, if we go over here, again, same exact bike. The only difference with this really is going to be that we have a SRAM X4 derailleur and an 8-speed cassette in the back and a chain drive, okay? So obviously, one of the things that is going to be common with a chain drive is it's going to be a lot easier to throw a derailleur on here and let this chain switch in between the sprockets in the back, you know, this rear cassette. So that just allows me to have an 8-speed, a 10-speed, whatever, right? It just allows me to have multiple speeds, and it makes hill climbing easier because opposed to, you know, the single speed, again, I'm locked into one gear and it can make hill climbing kind of tricky. However, with this, if I wanted to, I could switch to, you know, the first gear and just spin a lot faster, get up the hill a lot easier. However, you know, with a chain comes the risk of derailment. We'll see, you know, on this bike right here, we do have a chain guard on this side. So that's gonna help the chain from popping off towards the outside, but there's no chain guide on the other side here. So there is a possibility that the chain could pop off towards the inside of the bike. And that can just be annoying when I'm riding. If I do get a derailment, I have to stop, typically get my hands pretty dirty. So let's just go ahead and I'm gonna show you the difference between touching the you know, the belt drive over there. And I don't even know how dirty this is. Maybe nothing will show up, but I'm gonna just go ahead and put my fingers on this, just, you know, pretend like, oh, I'm putting it back on, I got a derailment. And yeah, you can see there's definitely some grease on my hands. Not a huge deal or anything, but if I do want to have something that's going to keep my pants as clean as possible for whatever reason, if I'm like driving this bike to work every day, you know, maybe a chain or a belt drive might be a better option. However, if I live in a hilly area, you know, maybe the chain drive would be a better option. Also with a chain drive, it allows me to keep this hub motor here in the back, or I could have a mid drive, or if I wanted to for some reason, I could have a hub motor in the front. And of course, like I was talking about, we could have that old like friction motor if I wanted to. But with a chain drive, really, there's just more options. I mean, this is the chain drive is the standard. This is what most people use for electric bikes and for non-electric bikes. The belt drive is somewhat of an anomaly. It's definitely less popular. There's not as many of them. But again, they're just kind of different. Each one is a little bit different.
Hey guys, I wanted to add a little bit to what Brent was sharing. I don't have Voltas in front of me, but I do have my mom's bike. Okay, so I'm gonna point a few things out in addition to what he said. I really wanna clarify that not all belt drives are single speeds. The thing is, they become more expensive when you add an internally geared hub like the Shimano Alphine or the Roloff Speed Hub, or especially the Navinci CVT that he was talking about. And the NuVinci in particular, it has like these orbs inside and it's really cool, but there's also this like friction fluid and it adds some weight. So it adds cost, it adds weight. They can be pretty tough because they're all contained right there in the hub versus having a derailleur that's external, can get bent if you're parking at a rack or if the bike tips over. But yeah, you can have gears. The other consideration is depending on the belt drive that you get, you know, he was looking at the Gates Carbon CDX and it has this center track design. So there's actually like a little track in between the little teeth on the belt rings and it's designed not to fall off either way. So they do tend to be, you know, pretty reliable that way. Whereas a lot of chains, they can fall off. The challenge is that in order to get that belt tight, you actually have to have some sort of a horizontal dropout on the back. And you could see that on the Volta that Brent was looking at. There's this silver piece and the rear wheel kind of slides backwards until that belt is taut. Okay, so some chain driven bikes have that and usually it is the single speed, you know, kind of that fixie culture that Brent was talking about. But that's just, it's a different style versus this vertical dropout on a more traditional bicycle. And the other really big consideration is in order to get a belt onto the bike, there has to be a cutaway on the frame. And usually it's right there on the seat stay on the right-hand side. And that requires some extra design work and engineering so that the bike is still strong, but that you have this gap that you can kind of disconnect and then slip the belt onto the frame. You'll notice with a chain like this, these links can be disconnected. So the chain can just be one long piece and then you kind of put it on and then connect it. With a belt, you can't disconnect it. You can't cut it. It's just one length. So they actually have to design the drivetrain around that length. You have to have that custom frame. You can't use a chain tensioner. You don't have the derailleur like this. So there's actually a lot that goes into it. It's not just like, oh, belt versus a chain. The whole frame has to be redesigned. Some companies like Rees & Mueller, they custom design their frames to not have a seat stay and a chain stay. They combine them into one long arm. Basically, you don't have to go through the frame. You can kind of go under the frame for that belt drive. And that's pretty special, pretty custom. I've looked at a few different belt-driven electric bikes in recent years, in recent months, actually. One of them was from eVelo, right? It's actually, they have a couple, I think, kind of use this. And I feel like there are more and more companies that are seeing the benefits of a belt drive. They're actually pretty reliable. It's a lot like a timing belt in your car. So with the carbon and sort of the Gates technology, you do get something that's quiet, that's relatively clean, something that's, you know, fairly efficient too, but there are those trade-offs. So I hope this helps to expand on what Brent was saying and give you some just some other perspectives on the topic. You know, if you're willing to spend a little bit of extra money, it could be a great solution. And it is quiet, but a lot of times if you don't have a gearless motor like that Volta, you might have the noise of the motor anyway on an electric bike, like, you know, going on. So it's like, does the chain really add that much to it? Are you concerned about reliability, the cleanliness? Anyway, I'm going to pass it back to him to finish this out, but worth considering. And I welcome your comments and stuff below or in the forums. We're going to post a guide on this. It's always nice to hear other people's perspectives because we're doing our best here, but there's a lot there and perhaps we missed something.
I hope that helps clarify some of the stuff for you guys, some of the main differences between belt drives and chain drives. They're really cool. It's just great that this industry has the options of going either way because, you know, it's different strokes for different folks. So that's really it, guys. This is kind of a short video, again, just to delineate the kind of the key differences between chain drives and belt drives. Hope you dug this video. If you are going out to ride, have fun and of course, ride safe, and I'll catch you next time.